Welcome to this Red Bull Music Academy lecture as part of Lisboa Electronica. As a nice fact to warm up for this afternoon, today marks the 20th anniversary of the first ever RBMA lecture. Yay, I like the enthusiasm, thank you. Which was with Jeff Mills in 1998 in Berlin. And it's very appropriate that on the 20th anniversary, we're doing more lectures. And our guest with us this afternoon is kind of one of those people in dance music that's been at the coalface of what's important. A lot of people who get celebrated in underground electronic music are true, the artists and the DJs who are important, but the people who turn up to work every day and put in the effort to get these records out and into your hands and really completely change the culture are the people that we want to talk to today. So please help me welcome Serge from Clone.
Thank you.
So, have you always been just Serge?
Well, no. When I used to play in a local club. That was 1988, when you guys started with the lectures. I was playing in a local club, and I had a V of my family name behind. So Serge V, Serge V. But I skipped the V at some point, and it was just my first name. I was never creative enough to find some cool name in.
So you're like the Electro Cher or Britney, just one name.
Well, something like that, yeah.
And what were you doing under the name Serge in these clubs? Paint us a picture of where you were and what kind of music you were playing at the time.
Well, that was kind of all over the place because I started in a local club and it was just like a commercial club in 88, 89. It was like a holiday. I'm coming from the coastal island in Holland on the southwest. And in the winter, there are living like 15,000, 20,000 people. In the summer, it was like 500,000. And you had like six clubs in the little town and all open for like 4 months, 6 or 7 days a week. And I started as a light jockey in one of them and brought my records on a Friday night and asked them if I could play them. And, you know, the local DJ always played a couple of cool tunes and I knew he had them. So I always asked him if he could play. And at some Friday, I brought some records. Hey, can you play these? Yeah, I'll put them on yourself. I go drink a beer. So that's how I started down there. But they also played like all kind of stuff. So it went from the commercial top 40 tunes to a very unknown underground US import stuff. And that went on. I've been playing there for like, I think until like 94, 95, something like that. Probably 94. So we played Gabber, we played Snap, Rhythm is a Dancer. We played all the cool old Chicago releases. So it was like quite various what we played, quite versatile. Even the early trance stuff from Frankfurt and that kind of stuff.
So when you say it was a commercial club, it wasn't just like commercial, like top 40 stuff, like you were saying, you were also balancing that with quite hard and like cutting edge underground dance
music.
Yeah,
we could play almost anything there as long as the dance floor was full. And we were three DJs and I had my personal taste. So I always tried to play my own records that I brought. I think a lot of people in these days don't know how it was back then, but very often the club used to buy the records. So you went to the record shop with the club owner and he paid for all the records. But he never wanted to buy the records that I liked, so I bought them myself and sneaked them in and played them in the club anyway. So I was took them myself. And that was back then, it was always the more Detroitish stuff that he didn't want to pay for. He said, no, we can't play that. And he always, you know, bought a bit more commercial things. So I bought the Transmet stuff and KMS and the old warehouse records from Armando and Ron Trent. And it was kind of a mixture kind of thing. And that slowly became more commercial because, he had to, make some money. And my taste went another way because the whole music scene was kind of splitting up. You did get a lot of subgenres. So you did get Chicago House, Detroit Acid or Detroit Techno and more acid stuff, electro things. And I started to play more of my own stuff, but I couldn't play everything there myself. So at some point I hooked up with guys in The Hague, from Acid Planet, Guy from Bunker, and I started playing there as well. So I was like doing two different gigs. I was playing in this commercial club, and I was playing in the most obscure underground parties in Holland as well.
That's so interesting that you were almost at the mercy of the club owner for what records that were getting bought in. If you weren't getting them through him because he didn't like what you wanted to play, where were you getting your records from? Was it mostly through other places in the Netherlands, or were you looking to abroad? Like late 80s, so how's that working?
Yeah, it was like late 80s, early 90s. Well, you had a couple of import shops. And because we were on the south side of Holland, southwest side, we did go to Antwerp, Belgium. We did go to Rotterdam. So we're kind of in the middle between Antwerp and Rotterdam. So we did visit both cities. Every other week we went to Antwerp, and the other week we went to Rotterdam and bought stuff down there. And the most import shops did have all of it. So they had the really obscure stuff, but also the more commercial stuff. And that's also what we played. And also if you did go to a regular club, like the most famous house club in Holland was Roxy. Even down there you heard the like tracks releases, obscure house music, but also like the hip house stuff, which was a little bit more commercial. So everything was played at one night. You even could play like, you know, if the DJ fancied it, he played it like a reggae record or whatever. Just, you know, as long as it matched in with the vibe of the night.
If you were traveling to Antwerp and other cities in the Netherlands to get this music, it kind of makes it sound like it's like your band of merry men, like we're the only ones that like this stuff. Was there an appetite for it in the Netherlands at the time?
Yeah, definitely. There was a large scene in Holland and Belgium for the very new modern records coming from the US, but also a lot of producers in our area. So it was very lively. A lot of new exciting things were happening. Very obscure records made it to the charts as well. Like 88 was probably like the momentum for the new beat stuff. And obscure Chicago house records made it to the charts as well. And a major company started to sign obscure techno records. So it became more, you know, it was kind of mingling up with the major label stuff.
When you said that there's like a splintering at that time between genres and what people were into, could you give us maybe examples of what people in The Hague might have been producing and listening to, and maybe what people in Rotterdam might have been doing that was different?
I think The Hague, Rotterdam was more or less the same. The two cities are really close by, like 20 kilometers. Those two cities are more working class. So in the weekend, people want to celebrate. So that, you know, that gives a different atmosphere. People are working hard during the week, and during the weekend they go out and, you know, forget about the work stress and whatever was going on. So they want to party and rave. And that's the music what was being made in Rotterdam and The Hague a lot. But on the same time, you also had guys doing like really obscure stuff and very intimate music. So it's people always, you know, wanna pinpoint what, okay, this is coming from there, but you know, all sorts of music were made everywhere. But I think the dominant thing in Holland or in Rotterdam and The Hague was like the harder techno at some point, and the really easy house stuff that was going down in the clubs.
Is there a track maybe from this pile of records you brought that you would like to play to illustrate that?
Yeah, no, of course. I got some records that I want to play, but maybe because most stuff that I brought, and when things started splintering, as you said, is around 91, 92. So in 91, 92, you were getting the commercial trance stuff. Also in Britain, in the UK, in Holland we did get the harder techno sound, the Gabber stuff, and on the other side from the harder styles you did get the more mellow house stuff, and that sound was popularized quite fast. So around 92, 93, you had like two main streams in Holland. So it was like the harder commercial Gabber with the trancey stuff, and the dominant clubhouse thing. And at that point, I really felt like I was falling in between something, like, because I didn't like both of them. And there was a lot of good music coming out, but you couldn't, it was hard to find in Holland around that time. And also in that period, 91, 92, a lot of really good releases were coming out from all kind of corners of the world. Underground Resistance started, the guys, you know, Carl Craig started Planet E around the time, Retroactive. A lot of people, a lot of guys, producers started their own label. And also the guys from Bunker started around 92. And that was also the period that I started my label, and that a lot of producers from, I think it was like the second or maybe even third generation, started producing music and they put it out on vinyl and started playing that and organizing their own parties. So that's also what was happening in Holland. And I think it's good to start with the first record I did put out. That was the number one. There was also the sound that we were into. It was like harder acid stuff and, you know, alternative things that were like kind of counterculture of the more commercial streams, more commercial club things going on.
You do, yes, the honors.
I'll put my mic down.
Okay. So, what exactly is this record then?
This is the first clone release. I saved up some money and had a couple of tracks that I made with and also with a friend, two friends actually. We shared a little studio, and I did release a 12-inch on the label from IF. The guys from Bunker are releasing music, so we had a small group of people putting out music. And I thought, well, okay, I saved some money. I did a couple of jobs, and I thought, well, I see the other guys doing it. Let's just send the debt to the manufacturing, and I pay the bill, and we'll see where it goes from there. And, you know, we can play the tracks on the party, because back then you needed to have vinyl to be able to play them on a party. So it was kind of, you know, essential to have a record out back then.
So what's the title of this track that we're going to listen to?
No titles. No.
Extra Underground. Sorry.
Yeah, I think I made some kind of, it was Coordinated Sounds and Sequences. That's the EP title. Because I, well, you know, didn't have any names, and I think I marked them C.11 for the first track, 1.2 for the second one, and up to 4, and then the second release had like 2.1, 2.2.
But why all the sequencing rather than giving it track titles? Was that an aesthetic choice?
Because we were making a lot of tracks. And it was just tracks, and well, we didn't put up names, we just gave them a number, like, you know, like the classical works, Opus 1, yeah. Opus 2, and I just gave them, you know, a number, 1.1 for the first release and the second release. But the titles are not even on the record. I don't think they were on the second and the third and the fourth record. It was all no titles, just an EP name, and that's it.
Well, let's listen to that.
I'll pull the sound a bit down.
Yeah, great. When you say, obviously, this is not the kind of stuff that I could play in the club, it's not so obvious to me, maybe.
Well,
so
maybe
why?
Not these days, but back then, like, everything that was going in the club was like, you know, Snap Rhythm is a dancer, or like the things that made it to the charts, like Farley Jack Master Funk, Love Can Turn Around. You had some acid stuff, but it was all more like gimmicky. This was like more dark, and it, you know, this is stuff that you're listening to in a dark basement with a strobe light and a lot of smoke, and just forget about everything. In a regular club, it's, you know, it has to be cozy, people drinking beer, you know, chatting up with girls or whatever. That's a little bit the vibe in most clubs, and sometimes it's, you know, you can rave, but this was like a completely different atmosphere.
What year did you release this in then?
I think, this is the first release, and I think it came out the end of 92, so early 92, we got everything ready, we did send it out, the whole manufacturing process. This was being pressed in the Czech Republic. I don't even know if it was a republic back then, and it was Czechoslovakia back then, close to Prague. So it was Eastern Germany, right? Probably, yeah, it was before the wall, I don't even know, doesn't matter. But So it's like really thick vinyl, and the quality is actually not that good, but we really liked the thickness of the vinyl. And it was like a very obscure manufacturing, and I don't think we had to pay the mechanical royalties, so that's why we pressed up there, so we could save a couple of hundred guilders back then. Yeah.
So you started the label in 92. Was that originally with the intent of releasing your own music first? Was that the idea?
Actually, yes. Yeah. Yeah, because I was sending demos to some other labels, and I already thought that, well, okay, that's kind of a hassle because you have to wait, you know, and get approval for them and think, wait what they like. And, wait on what they think of it. So I thought, well, let's just do it myself, you know. And I had a couple of good examples because most of the labels that I did like, Underground Resistance was one of them, and a lot of good producers from Chicago in the late 80s, they all had their own small label and just, you know, saved up some money and pressed a record without the idea of starting a proper record label or having a company behind it. You know, of course, there were labels making a lot of money and doing it in a more commercial way, but like Underground Resistance, just pressed up records with no information. Black label and just UR004, and that's it. That's all the info you had. And that was the stuff that I was really attracted to because the techno music that we like had a certain aesthetics that I liked and that were part of the, you know, the techno sound in that time. And so I thought, okay, we'll just press up some records and then, well, no plan behind it.
It's interesting that you say that there wasn't a lot of information about these records when they were coming out at the time, like Underground Resistance, but there was information, but it was just highly aestheticized, like precise information, like calling records Acid Rain and having like messages carved in the runout. The information that you could get was solely on the record itself. There was no press or PR. There was just inlays and insert labels. Was that inspiring for you?
Yeah, well, there was a kind of thing that was going on because it was about the music. And there was a little message that you could give with the record, but it was kind of counterculture of the whole commercial scene and what was going on with the major labels. And that was kind of the part that's part of the techno culture, I think, and also the tradition that we got now in that's going on in techno. And we were kind of, you know, following that aesthetics we were part of that whole thing. And we didn't feel any urge to put information on there. Why should we put on a phone number? Or why we didn't have an email back then? So why put on any information? Later we did put on a fax number or something like that. But there was like a whole scene with people making fanzines, like the, you know, small magazines and stuff like that. So you could connect and you knew where the parties were and people were meeting up in record stores. So it was kind of, you know, people had to listen to the music and it was not important who was behind it or who made it, and you could make a little store like Acid Rain, you probably get something like pretty raw or something. Or so you could get a little vibe from the music with the label art or, you know, the information that was not there. And so that's what we did as well.
When did you give the Clone label a physical home? You mentioned that you linked up with a skate shop originally in 93, 94?
I think that was a little bit later. In 93 or 94, I think IF opened his shop, a Hot Mix in The Hague, which was kind of our club shop, our club house, or if you can all call it like that. Guy van Bunker was living in The Hague. IF was living close to The Hague. So we hang out in his shop, and we all had our label and our small things. We were playing at parties during the weekends. He closed down, I think, end of 94. He was only open for like 1.5 years, very short. And there was no replacement at some point, so I just opened my small shop. We still had some stock left from the release we did on our own labels. And I just rented a small space and opened the record shop. Mm.
I remember you saying that there was something to do, there was like a connection to skateboarding in the early days, like skaters would come in the shop or it was linked to like a local kind of skate crew. Was that part of the culture integral to like early days of Clone at all?
Not really. It was just a coincidence that I could join that location. I was a surfer, I skate a little bit, but I was I used to be almost full-time surfer because I was living in and I didn't do much else in my teenager years until music grabbed me. And but you know, yeah, well, skateboarding is like an urban thing as well. So it fits kind of to the techno thing as well. A lot of people like Jeff Mills used to skateboard as well. He was the old guy back in Detroit. He was skating instead of being a gang member. Skateboarding is a thing that's pretty good to a lot of kids in cities, yeah.
I've just got a really good mental image of Jeff Mills skateboarding. It's great. Thanks for that. That's great. Tell me about like the early days of the record shop then, because if you started the label to release your own music, when did you make that kind of like editorial decision to open a shop and cultivate this entity?
Well, it all went kind of natural because I was traveling to Germany quite a lot in that period because of a girl who was living in Frankfurt. And that's the reason why I was visiting Frankfurt quite a lot. And you had a couple of good distributors down there. Those distributors sold my records, so I went there, sold them my records, and I could buy them. I could buy some import stuff there as well. And in that time, you had a lot of imports that the local shops in Holland didn't buy anymore because it was too obscure. Because we had those two big commercial streamings that were like dominating the and that was falling in between. And that was that was mainly like the old Detroit techno that I like so much that I couldn't get, and I bought it down there. But also a lot of good house music was being made in that period, and I bought those copies down there, and I bought some copies for friends. So I just take two and then I sell it to my buddy. And at some point I thought, well, okay, you know, I know these guys with the skate shop, and I just start something there, and we'll see if I was just open 3 days in the week, and it went kind of naturally.
I know that because you were a DJ when you started out, I wonder how much the DJing came full circle in the early days of the shop. Were you in the shop being like the DJ salesman, like putting records on and going, come on, this sounds really good?
No, but people didn't know much about DJs back then. I mean, I was a DJ, was a shitty job. For a lot of people, you know, a bartender made more money than the DJ. And I think I was making like 40 guilders. So there's like 20 euros for a night DJing. And at the end of the night, the DJ's task was to clean all the ashtrays. So I had to pick all the ashtrays in the venue and clean them and then put them back. That was my job after, you know. So after the club was closed, that was my, and you know, the bartender cleaned the bar and the doorman was sweeping the floor. So everyone had a task cleaning the club. And my task was doing the ashtrays.
So nice.
For 40 guilders at night.
So obviously DJing wasn't particularly lucrative or well regarded. So the shop and the label then was a way to anchor yourself in Rotterdam as this place where you could get imported records, or like you say, the records that people didn't really want from like the chilled out house and then the harder gabber stuff. Do you think that when you started the shop, people were coming in and going, what's this?
Like, totally. A lot of people came in. We had I was located in around the corner from the main shopping street to the main record shopping street in Rotterdam back then. I think we had about 5 or 6 import shops or stores that were selling dance music. One of the main ones was Hot Sound, who were having their own labels in Midtown, selling the Gabber stuff. Midtown was like the main Gabber shop, and they also sold the commercial housey stuff. Then, well, there was a drum and bass shop, and everyone had their own thing. So I was kind of the odd one in between them, selling the strange stuff like electro stuff and records. They, you know, the guy thought, well, okay, who's buying this kind of stuff? But I knew, because I was playing at those underground parties and I was having friends, and it was also like a small scene of people collecting records. So there was like a pretty lively scene of record collectors. And that's how I knew people like Gert. He was like a record collector. Speedy J, Jochen Paap was a collector. A couple of guys working for me, I knew from back then, when I was looking in the local magazines and they were selling records, and I went to their house. They were all still living with their parents, and I met up, and I, you know, we swapped records because they were looking for this and I was looking for that, so we made a deal, or changed synthesizers or stuff like that. So that's how you did meet people, and so there was some kind of scene, and you did meet each other when Underground Resistance or Larry Heard was playing. You saw all the familiar faces, so you were making friends as well, but you know, in person.
So you started to make friends with people like Gerd Janssen through the pages of like a nerdy magazine.
No, not Gerd Janssen. Gert, the Dutch Gert. Oh. That was always the yeah. Gert was like the local producer. He was doing a lot of music. He still is doing a lot of music. Yeah, yeah. They're getting confused a lot. Gert Janssen said that he owed a lot of gigs to Gert, because a lot of people knew Gert's record, but knew Gert Janssen as a DJ, so they thought that he also produced those records. But
how long is it before he started to tell people, "I'm not actually that guy"?
Like, I'm not sure if he ever told them.
You're swindled, Gerd. Is there something we can listen to then from that time that you've got that could just get us all in the mood? Because all you're talking about a lot of genres, a lot of splintering off, kind of like, yeah. Even the shops seem a little bit tribal. So maybe there's something we could play that really reminds
you
of that time.
Yeah, let me think. Because we're talking about like 94. I think the first Drexia releases came out around that time. Drexia, Ectomorph, Underground Resistance, those kind of things. Also, a lot of good house records came out, like Ron Trent, Prescription, with his label. And Chez Damier, KMS did put out a lot of good house records. Jovan in New York, a lot of guys in New Jersey put out really good house records. So it was an era that with a lot of good stuff. So maybe a Drexia thing, or let me see what we got here.
Because we are definitely going to talk about Drexia later on, for sure.
Okay. Oh, well, maybe let's do a very odd one. We haven't discussed that one before, but that's a nice, really strange record coming out in that time. That was like really odd, especially if you figure out the time where people are. You could make a lot of money with selling records. So a lot of producers were making records and made a lot of money back then, and were easily attracted to the techno scene, or the more commercial techno scene, or the house. But then all of a sudden you had some guys doing stuff that was like really, well, completely crazy. Let me see. It is one.
And what's this called?
This is Glass Domain, Interlock. I like that part.
Yeah. There's always another good part.
Yeah.
There's always another good part.
Well, not always, but with some with good records it is, yeah.
So what was that record there? Tell us about who was making that.
This is Glass Domain. It's now it's no secret anymore. It's Gerald from Doppler Effect, Gerald Donald, who made this. And he's also talking about Lego blocks, being creative. Looking for new stuff, making music that he likes, or that's, you know, a creative expression. And when you hear this, when everyone is looking for club tunes and the big records and the next chart hit, that was, you know, that was like the golden thing for DJs, was having the next big club hit before anyone else had it. So if you were able to buy an obscure US import release, which probably came out like 4, 5, 6 months later on a European label, you could already play it for like 4 or 5 months in your club before anyone else could play it. So everyone was looking for that kind of records. And then all of a sudden you hear this record in a record shop. Most buyers didn't even care for it. But when I heard this stuff, and I must be honest, I didn't hear this at that time because it was too obscure. We couldn't find this in Holland. I don't think this even made it outside of Detroit back then. But this is one of the guys from Drexia, and we knew Drexia. We heard the records from Drexia and from Ectomorph and those guys. So we were like completely excited when we heard crazy stuff like this, like guys doing other things, not looking for the next club hit, but just being creative and expressing themselves and doing stuff that they liked. And well, that was when some kind of click was being made, that we thought, okay, well, there are more people doing this. And there was people in Detroit making electro music. Well, around the same time, we were making electro stuff as well. And nowadays, when you listen to a lot of music on YouTube, you can find the most crazy or obscure stuff. But back then, it was kind of hard finding different music, finding something that was like strange and obscure, or that fell into your niche. So finding these records, well, it was like, you know, very exciting back then. And you couldn't find these in most regular record stores, not even Drexia. And that's the stuff that I wanted to sell, because I liked it.
Mm. So maybe moving from Clone as a label and then a record shop, was this kind of like the editorial kind of impetus to start being a distributor? Because if you're finding it hard to get like a conversation going so much between like electro in the States and electro that's happening in the Netherlands, was becoming a distributor part of the way for you to go, right, this is how we're going to facilitate this relationship?
No, that was only later, I think. Okay. Yeah, because at first we started just because we were enthusiastic about this stuff. When I opened the shop, the label work slowed down. But at some point, I was meeting more people in the shop, and I got more demos. So at some point, I think it was like release 7, I started releasing music from other people. All the first 6, 7, or maybe even 8 releases were all by myself. And from there, I started releasing other people's music. And then I had to make agreements and deals with people. So it became more official. And I had a shop as well. And my aim with the shop was selling records that I liked. And I liked this stuff. And I liked, you know, Excess, Minimal Nation, that kind of stuff. And they simply didn't sell it in the other shops, because those were not things that were running in most regular clubs, except for a couple of small underground places. And so that's kind of how the whole thing started rolling. And I was trying to get these records in my shop. And the distribution part only, I think it happened like 89 or something.
When you had your first run of releases on the label that were all by yourself, when you started to release music from other people, were the local producers coming into the shop with their demos and saying, oh, please listen to this?
Yeah. Well, you know, it was like kind of a network with friends, like, you know, Facebook without a computer. So you knew each other, and they showed each other, but in person. So they said, oh, listen to this, you know, just because they like to play it for you. And then oh, wow, I thought that's good stuff. People should hear that. I really like that. And I should put it out, because now I can play it at parties as well. And so that's a bit how it started. And then I started with released by IF and a couple of friends. I think that was the number 7 or number 8, Brothers Fuck and Friends. Then I had a Pamitex release, and then then things slowly started to you know, become an official record label.
Things escalated.
It escalated from
very
there,
quickly.
Yeah.
It's good that you mentioned other labels trying to search for hits, because there's an interesting turning point in the early 2000s for Clone that I wanted to play a track of, and perhaps we could discuss it, because I feel a big part of the appeal, the enduring appeal of Clone, is its ability to shapeshift and maybe move through trends and around them, but also absorb them in their own way. So I have a track that I'm going to play, and I didn't tell you I was bringing this, in case you decided you didn't want to hear it. Could you put the laptop on? That would be great. You were just saying that you haven't heard that song in a long time. What was that song?
Sorry?
What was that song?
This is Adult, Hand to Phone. It was on the first 12-inch we released by them. And well, yeah, that's.
It's I played this because it's a really interesting turning point, I think, in the history of Clone. This was released in 2001, and then again as remixes in 2002. And that same year, it was on the Too Many DJs As Heard record. It was like the quintessential mashup album of the time, and that was featured on it. And when we're talking a lot about electro and the different styles from the US, from the Netherlands, and then creeping in at the start of the millennium, there is this early like electro clash sound, which is quite different, and which IF definitely had an early hand in. Can you tell us a little bit about the impact that this record had on Clone as an entity? Like, did you get a lot of interest from record buyers about this label? I'd be really interested to know more about it.
Yeah, I actually have to think about how it was back then. Because things already slowly started to grow. The shop became bigger. We attracted a lot of customers from outside of Holland. So a lot of people from Belgium, Germany came buying records. We were putting out a bit more records. I think it was release number 14. We were doing more parties. So the whole network became a bit bigger. We were releasing electro records, but also techno records. I got another one here that we're going to play later that was like a completely different direction, but all very valuable to me and very dear. But all of a sudden, this and other records in that era were being picked out by the club scene and by popular DJs and by the fashion press as well. So all of a sudden, the whole electro thing became some kind of revival thing, and it became some kind of fashion, which was kind of odd because fashion is the last thing we wanted to be, and that we were attracted to with the music, with the techno music that we liked, and so we were kind of pulled into a whole scene that we never used to be part of, and this was one of the big hits. In that time, this one, Hand to Phone, IF with Space Invaders had a big hit. Dexter, I Don't Care, Alden Tyrell, Love Explosion, and a couple of other things. All records from our crew, our scene, became kind of cult hits. And Miss Kitten and the Hacker from Munich, they had their big hit. That was kind of that era.
Did you find that record shops who perhaps hadn't really picked up on what you were doing with electro had started because of big records like this coming to you and going, do you have more of this stuff? Like, did it change like the conversations that you were having with other record shops in Europe or further abroad?
Kind of, but also the record label. So a lot of record labels started putting out music that sounded like this. And wanted, because you know, you could make money with selling records, so they thought, okay, well, if this is selling, we can make another good record that sounds like this and just sell equal numbers. And it did get a commercial kind of twist, commercial flavor around it. We were talking with major record companies who were interested in doing a full length album by Dexter or IF or Alan Terrell or Adult. And things became slightly different in that era.
You said you were approached by major labels to put out albums from these other artists. Like, what was your reaction? Because it seems like Clone's very much always been its own creature. How did you navigate that time?
Well, I always try to stay true to the thing that I liked and to what felt good. Also, most of the artists I'm working with had the same kind of thing, and we stayed true to our own aesthetics and ethics as well, and kept doing what we enjoyed doing, and was making music and releasing and playing music that we liked, and this whole electro clash kind of thing did put us in a lot of spotlights, and all of a sudden I was playing like fashion parties with models and coke and whatever was going on in those parties. But before we only knew from movies, all of a sudden we were in between those parties, but it felt kind of odd. And so I always kept a distance from that whole electro clash scene. And there were a lot of record companies becoming very popular, like Gigolo Records. They completely jumped on that whole movement and started putting out more records that sounded like things that were a hit. And so I always kept my distance from that and just, you know, kept doing what I liked. And
around that time then, what were you doing that was a slight counter to that narrative? What else were you doing? Because this is a time when Clone started to really diverge. We're putting out kind of smoother, almost like disco style thing. There was a Italo disco going on roughly the same time.
Yeah, that's also a little bit, that was more or less the same time that the Italo disco thing also came back, and that guys like Lagerwald, we got his record here, was making tracks that had some electro, Italo disco influences. But we played everything that we liked. So we played Afrika Mambaataa at an acid squad party, and we played obscure electronic disco at those parties as well. So a lot of things were going all together on the same night, and it was still kind of versatile. And of course there were parties where you only played like banging acid stuff, but even there, you played some electro in between or some crazy stuff on some Drexia. So it was always kind of versatile. It was never the whole night just straight on Berghain kind of techno. Like what you got now in Berghain is the whole night, the same sound. You don't even know if it's 1 o'clock or 6 or 10 in the morning.
I think that's part of the fun though, right?
It was always boring to me. So it was kind of, you know, during a night you always, you know, I think always the energy goes up and down. So if you come in, you are in a different mood and different energy than at 6 a.m. And at 10 a.m. It's again a different mood. So if the music goes on in a straight line, and so we perfectly could play all those different styles and things on a certain night, and those electro class parties that was like the whole night only like hits and chart stuff and popular music and at that time we started, you know, we released house records that were like completely different and people didn't really understand. Oh, but yeah, you are the guys from the obscure electro stuff. Why do you put out house music? Well, just because we like it.
Speaking of things you like, let's go back to Detroit and talk about maybe a defining feature of Clone. It's not only the music that you've released yourselves, but the music that you've sought out and reissued. And that's been a huge part of what you've done. Yep. Can we listen to Detroit in effect?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Yep. Yeah, that's also like quite early. That was like, I think, 86, 87, or this, 96, this, 97.
This Detroit in effect record originally came out in 97. Detroit level, is it MAP or MEP? And then you re-released it on Clone in 2003. So this is the year after the Soul Wax album that put out Adult in the mix. So this is like a year apart. This is all happening.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. You know your facts.
Well done. It's my job.
Good. I don't know which side I it is because it's the test pressing. So I'll have to gamble if it's this side or the other one.
So what were we just listening to there?
That's Detroit in effect, the man you'll never see. And this record came in. I recently did a small post about this, actually about this record on my Facebook. It came out via import. We never heard it before. So we just order records from the list from the US distributors. And once a week, once every 2 weeks, we got the US import delivery. And then you see a record on there, MAP Records, Detroit in effect, the man you'll never see. So we had no idea, but it sounded kind of cool. So I ordered like five copies because, you know, you had to be careful. Otherwise, it did cost me money. And at that time, we didn't have much, you know. And five copies in my small shop was still quite a lot. So then I did receive the box with these records in it. And, you know, always was excited opening the US imports. So I opened it, and then I heard this for the first time. I was like, whoa, was it, what, I mean, that's stuff that I don't hear here. No one is making this kind of stuff in Europe. And this was like classic stuff, but still but different than a lot of things being made. It has some reference to Cosmic Cars, by Cybertron. So these guys knew the classics, but it sounded different. It was fast. It was more like techno. I also like the vocals. The Man You'll Never See, me just making techno tracks, and by guys who were not in the limelight, so not in the spotlights. So these guys made it a tune that kind of fitted to the whole vibe that we liked, and not the electro clash thing going on in that time, the popular fashion parties, but like the completely the opposite, just guys making music that they liked, and we became friends. Adult made a remix, Electronome IF. So that was, I think that was the first license I did for the label, signing music that was out before and remixed it. That was like the first project I did. And I still like it a lot.
The reissues that Clone have done, like this one and many, many, many others, how much of a conscious decision do you make with finding these older electro records and bringing them into the fore and putting them out for popular-ish consumption again? Is this, in a kind of sense, a way to like not only just let people hear music, but to create a narrative of electro that you can control and you think is of a quality that deserves to be heard?
Well, it was just records that we couldn't find and that were important. So I thought I should make them available again, because it's records that I used to play a lot and that I thought were important records and very good records that people should know about and that are part of the whole culture and about the whole history of house and techno music. For me, it's always the same. House and techno, it's electro, it's all, it's just one thing. I never divided that much. We started making contacts with people, like this was like one of the first things, and but then I thought, okay, maybe we should do more official and make like a label focusing on reissues of tracks that are classics and that are important. So we started with Mike Dunn, MD3, Face the Nation, a couple of Italo disco releases, and slowly we had a reissue label where we're repressing, remastering, and re-releasing old house and techno records, and electro as well.
Staying in Detroit, as we mentioned a couple times before, we won't keep people holding on any longer. The relationship that you've built up with Drexia over the years has been of paramount importance to the history of Clone. You released the Grava album in 2004, and it was the first time it had been released. It wasn't 2004.
I don't know the dates.
Okay, hang on.
Probably like 2002. I don't know.
It would have been 2002, because that was the same year that James Stinson passed away. When you decided to have a relationship with Drexia and build that up and release those records, how did you start that conversation? Did you approach the duo and say that you wanted to do this? Where did this interest come from?
I have to think how that went. Well, it was like a small network, so we knew people in Detroit who were friends with others who were making records. So it was a small network. Also people in Glasgow, people in Italy, in Rome mainly, Germany, Detroit, Miami. And it was just a small network. The internet got a role in that as well, because that was also around the era that the internet became more accessible and more mainstream. So a lot of artists and people had their own website. I don't know what the first contact was or how that did go. I remember the first time I spoke to him, but I think it probably was an email after we noticed a website or something. I don't know how the first contact was made, but and then he offered new music, and that's how it. And I was already working with Adult and a couple of other people, so they already knew about Clone Records. We invited some people coming over, so they knew about us. The Drexia guys and the mothers knew that we were doing a label, and he wanted to release some music, and he approached me, and that's how we made the first deals.
What kind of conversations did you have with Drexia about maintaining the integrity of their narrative and their ideas and their aesthetic?
None.
Was it just kind of like an unspoken rule that you would completely honor everything that they gave you? Or did you discuss?
It was just part of the whole thing. I mean, it was like anonymous. Nobody knew who was behind it. And it was like that record, The Man You'll Never See. And in those years, there was almost no fame. You could become famous if you were like Derek May, Kevin Saunderson. But most people only knew the music. Nowadays, it's the other way around. You know the people, but you don't know what kind of music they made. So you know, for example, Peggy Goo. I knew Peggy Goo from the internet, Facebook, because she showed up in my timeline and people liked stuff before I knew who she was. And I had no idea what kind of music she was playing and what kind of records she made. I didn't even know it. But I saw her in my timeline a couple of times passing, you know, coming by. And I knew about Peggy Goo. But I had no idea what she was doing. Back then, it was completely the other way around. Everyone knew Cosmic Cars by Cybertron. Everyone knew all the Model 500 things, but no one knew who was Juan Atkins. Nobody knew who was behind Detroit in Effect. Nobody knew who was behind Drexia or Underground Resistance was a bit more known. But you all knew the records. So it was the other way around. And there was no discussion about talking who made those records. It was kind of obscure, and I think only we kind of followed what he was doing. So if he spoke about a new project, I think he came out in public with his Seven Storms, that he was going to release seven full-length albums. So that was information he gave to the outside world. So that was the information we had, and we also shared, but we never shared who he was or what he was doing, what kind of job he had or whatever. Mm. That was kind of, it was not important.
When you released the Grava album, that was you being given music and you released it on good faith. But there'll be later years with Clone Classic Cuts between 2011 and 2014 when you released reissued Drexia records, but you did have a much more hands-on time with those records because a lot of them were remastered, correct?
Yeah. Yeah, but we also had to do a lot of work with Gravophore. The business was not like, you know, friends coming in the record shop giving you a tape. It was like a proper label already. There was money involved. I mean, we had to pay a large advance for that as well, and you know, we had to make promotion. We had to sell a certain amount of copies to make it worth doing. So it was like more professional already in those years. I mean, we were talking with major record companies with those with those Adult things and making deals and getting a lot of licenses. So the business was already mature. It was like the question was, the Gravophore was only came years after that. So Gravophore was first. Then we had another one, Leprat XL. We were talking to other guys about reissuing stuff, but also releasing new music from other people from Detroit and Miami and all over the world. It was like a regular, kind of regular label business thing.
There's someone that's not here with us who is also really important to the integral story of Clone, and that's Alden Tyrell. And yeah. I think we should speak about him.
Yes, of course.
Who is Alden Tyrell, for those who may not be so familiar?
Alden Tyrell is a friend of mine. We became friends through the record shop. He came in with a friend of his, and he you know, just a regular customer, and we did meet on parties and stuff like that. And then I think he gave me a tape, or a friend of him gave me a tape with music he was making. And he was like, and I thought, well, that's really good stuff. So like a lot of those stories, you know, I started talking with him, and we came to our first record we did put out. There was, I think the EP was called Obsession, or the track on there was Obsession. But he was doing a lot of electro stuff. He was a very talented producer. He was doing a very good electro stuff. He was doing some disco stuff. But he actually was like a hip-hop guy. He was like very much into hip-hop, and he looked like a hip-hop guy. He was behaving like a hip-hop guy as well.
What did he look like when you met him? Like, how did he look like a hip-hop guy?
You know, Air Jordans, and you know, baggy trousers, and you know, a bit.
So not Electro Clash at all.
Not Electro Clash at all. No. But nobody was like, what's Electro Clash? You know, nobody was like. Danny Legowald was like completely different. I was like a more surfer kind of guy. IF was IF, and the other guys from Alkmaar. That was like also an important part of our scene. The guys in the north part of Holland, on the coastal part there, with Electronome, Cosmic Force. So we were like all completely different characters, but we got along because of the music, and we had the same taste and the same aesthetics there. So Alan Terrell became friends. We did put out a couple of records, and he's like really producer kind of guy and doing really good stuff. So at some point we got a couple of records that also was in that time frame with the Electro Clash, and he was doing a lot of different things, and we also shared a love for the modern electronics, like Ottakura, Aphex Twin, that kind of stuff. That's something we're not talking about here, but that was also like, that's proper techno stuff, and we were always looking forward to what was coming next, and that was for us the last level in techno music, Ottakura, Aphex Twin, the latest electronical developments, the latest software, Max came along. So that was like the last frontier for us for electronic music. And Alan Terrell was very skilled and very talented, did a lot of really good records. Very high-tech, but on the other side, he was doing also kind of retro kind of things. But because he was so skilled in the production side, he started doing mastering for us. And that's the thing that you told me before that you wanted to talk about in correlation to the Drexia thing. So
Alden Tyrell was kind of brought into the clone way of doing things, and was mastering and engineering records, including the Sea Dweller series for Drexia that you did on Clone Classic Cuts from 2011 to 2014.
Yep.
And I kind of want to give people a sense of when people may have potentially heard this Drexia music on vinyl for the first time in their own hands. There's a very particular sound that Clone worked on through Alden Tyrell to make Drexia sound the way they did for these reissues. But what we're going to do is we're going to play the same track from the original, from the Quest, and then play the Clone remaster of it, so you can get a sense of the role that Clone plays in not just putting the music out there in your hands, but actually affecting the very like fabric of the tracks. So what's the track we're going to compare and contrast?
I think you had Red Hills of Lordosa.
I did have the Red Hills of Lordosa. Let me just check I got the right one. Yeah. So what we're going to do is play both. Shall we play the older version first?
Yeah.
So this is from The Quest. So I hope you got a sense of that, those two different sounds, those tracks. Tell us a little bit more about what Alden Tyrell was doing with these remasters, like getting his hands on these tracks. How did the process work, and what was the thinking behind Clone going in and touching this music?
Well, I think I have to add, that's a played from the computer. I think it's an MP3, so there is some difference. The difference is very big now. I think it's less of a big difference in if you play both vinyls, but there is a huge difference. It's a little exaggerated with these two, but yeah, now you can hear more space and more balance in the sound here. there are a couple of reasons. That has been mastered in Detroit. I think Ron Murphy did cut those. And he had a special way of mastering. We had the master tapes from all these tracks. So we just mastered it in a way we should do it. We would do it nowadays. We heard a lot of things in the music that we didn't hear before from the old records. So we thought, okay, if you're gonna reissue them, we should not present them the way they used to come out, like the original UR releases. Those UR releases are like magical records to us. The whole concept, the whole artwork thing, the whole story around the music, also how they've been mastered by Ron Murphy, because he got like a certain aesthetics to it, and he got like a certain vision in the mastering as well. So we thought, well, we cannot compete it or compare it with that. We should bring it in another context. So we just made whole new playlist. We made four different releases out of the whole collection. The music got remastered, and we also wanted the people to hear the parts that you couldn't hear on the original releases, or at least master them in a different way, so you could listen to them in probably the way they have been heard in the studio while being made, because this is what you could hear in the studio when it was being made, and not with Ron Murphy's vision on it. So that's a little bit what we wanted to do with the new mastering and how we want to present it.
What, when you say there were certain things on these Drexia tracks that were not being heard, what specifically do you mean? Could you give us an example of how Ron Murphy's work may have been changed, or like, I'm not sure. I think it would be great if you could give us examples, because to go in and change someone's record is quite a fundamental thing, to bring certain things to the fore and tone certain things down.
It is, yeah, it is. But that's also the thing with the mastering in Detroit from Ron Murphy. He was mastering things so you could play it very loud, and things had a certain raw edge to it. And that's also, I mean, that's part of the charm of it as well. But since we were doing reissues, we thought, okay, we shouldn't try to make it sound like those. We should make them sound as they sound in the studio, and just try to make them sound properly, and including the low end and some mid things that normally got like pressed together. So you couldn't hear a couple of parts, or you know, small frequencies or things that were hidden in those Ron Murphy mastered versions. And well, that's what Alan Terrell did. He did a good job, I think. We did put a lot of time in it, and especially Alan Terrell did put a lot of time in the mastering. There was a lot of work because it was all from the original tapes, multi-tracks, and well, at the end we had like the full catalog reissued in a new sounding quality.
Do you feel a sense of responsibility when you're doing these remastered works? Do you feel that it's something that you're kind of, even if you're able to get your hands in those tapes, is it something that you fundamentally should do, if that makes sense?
Well, we had to make some couple of choices, we tried to do it what felt best to us. And so we also discussed with a couple of people who were involved, and we thought, okay, we shouldn't reissue them as the original UR releases, or as the original versions, or with the original track listing. So we try to create a different way of listening to Drexia, to keep the original ones intact. Because those records, we can't touch them. We don't want to touch them. That's like all the props are going, all the kudos is going to Mike Banks for that, and the guys who, and also the guys making the music. So we try to create a new context. Right. And well,
And who is that new context for, do you think? Who is this for? People that buy clone records that don't own these old
records? Also for yourself, because we always look what we like and what we would like to see or like to do. And if we want to listen to Traxxia in a different way, I mean, otherwise we would play the original records. So we want to have a different way that we also could listen and play them. And that's what we had in mind. And also in mind, okay, what would be a good reason for people to buy these records, even if you have a couple of the originals? So it's a very good reason having the original ones and the reissues, if you're really into Traxxia. So that's, you know, we tried to figure out what the best thing was to do when we came to this, and present the music in a clean, clear way without the whole story around it, because that's the whole legacy of Traxxia. We try to keep that intact and just give a kind of maybe a little bit like I did with the first release, just giving numbers to the tracks and let the music do the talking and not give the whole image around, because that was already done before by others.
So speaking of Alden Tyrrell's work, why don't we listen to one of his own tracks?
Yes.
Let's do that.
Another.
What have you brought? I know we're just gonna have a mess here for now.
But I don't know how much time we've got left. We could do a disco one. We got plenty of time left.
We'll be fine.
Yeah.
This is fun.
Yeah, because there is one record that I really want to play because I like, but I know you like the disco thing, so I'll grab it out.
Make a concession. It'd be good so people can hear Alden Tyrrell's work as a producer that's part of the Clone family, not just as his mastering work on other people's records. So, what is this one?
Yeah, I mean, if I play this, you will hear his music is always sounding massive. He's doing a lot of techno stuff now, because he's always moving forward and doesn't want to repeat too much the same kind of thing. And so he has been doing a lot of disco, kind of really powerful disco stuff before. And that's what a lot of people know him of. And this is probably one of my favorite tracks of that Disco Lunar module. And this one is like really heavy and dark, but on the same in the same time he was also doing like almost kitschy, campy kind of stuff, even though it wasn't meant to be camp. I don't think that's the right word I picked, but especially knowing that he was kind of hip-hop guy, going to all the early hip-hop shows in Holland and producing really, really heavy beats and really cool stuff. He also was doing this kind of stuff. So it's a little schizophrenic almost, being a hip hop guy wearing the latest coolest Air Jordans and on the same side making Italo disco kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And but that's a little bit the thing that we all have. We are playing like really obscure electro stuff, but also really warm house records by Larry Heard, and so it's not like a scene or a genre or like a style of thing that you belong to. It's not like that you are belonging to a group. It was just, you know, about the music. If it sounded good, it sounded good, and this sounded good. He was just having fun in the studio making disco tracks, and he came to us with a tape. Hey, I made some disco tracks. And he thought, wow, that's cool. What's that? Yeah, it's the tracks I made. And we thought, well, did you make that? I mean, you make those really heavy hip hop tracks and electro tunes, and that's a little bit the whole vibe that we had in that time. And actually, still that we still still try to maintain and stay true.
Speaking of staying true, in 2009, you maybe weren't fed up. I don't know what your thinking might have been, but you actually stopped doing Clone for a short period of time. You basically put out the announcement that Clone's done for now, and people were quite shocked. And then you didn't stay done for very long. What happened when you came back with Clone in 2009, 2010?
Yeah, it was, I don't know. It was probably like a record label midlife crisis kind of thing or something. It was a moment where you had, okay, well, we're doing so many different things. It's kind of, I use the term schizophrenic. It didn't make sense to a lot of people. How can you put out like this Italo disco tune, very, you know, playful and catchy, and Drexia on the same time. But what's the link in that? A lot of people didn't see the link, and we became older, but there were was like a whole new generation coming into the music scene and interested in music. And I felt that there was like some disconnection. I couldn't make the connection with them. And I was thinking, I don't know what I'm doing. I mean, I put out a really good Scott Grooves record, but people are, are you putting out house stuff? And a lot of customers came in because of Drexia or because of Alan Terrell or because of Duplex or some Detroit techno records we were putting out. So it felt like, you know, there were a lot of expectations from people from outside, and you feel that you don't match the expectations they have. On one side, you don't really care, but on the other side, you always, you know, hear that in the shop. Oh, the new clone, but why is that a house record? Because I thought you guys are an electro label. So we got like a stamp on it that we were like an electro label, and we never tried to be an electro label. And the guys I was working with were just doing whatever they liked, and we played whatever we liked. And still now, I'm not an electro DJ, I'm not a house DJ or not a techno DJ. I just play whatever I like. And also, from a DJ perspective, my agent often says, yeah, but you have to make a choice, become a house DJ or just play techno. I can't, because I like everything. And I think during the whole night, you can start with house stuff and end up with like 140 BPM techno stuff or whatever. So I can split up myself as a DJ. I could make different artist names and play house as on that part, or play techno on with that alias, or how do you say that, with that name. But I felt that I had to change something with the label, because I thought, at least I felt, that I couldn't get deep enough into certain sounds. I couldn't release music from really unknown artists who were doing like really cool stuff, but didn't match the standard that we did set for ourselves, because the label did, you know, became a professional label, or, you know, whatever professional is, but like a proper record label. And things had to sound like proper as well. And then I got this really cool demo, and I thought, oh, well, yeah, but if I put that out, then I don't know what people will think of it. And, you know, so I was starting to think in that way, and I didn't like that. I wanted the label to be pure and just release the music that I like. And even if it's like really soft, melodic house or very introvert or whatever. So I thought, okay, just stop and think of ways how to do it again, or maybe another way, or maybe not at all, maybe stop at all. So we kind of quit the whole operation and the label, how we were doing it. And in the time I thought of ways how I could release those records of those young artists again, and new producers and young talented people who were doing different things, and give them a platform where I could release their music, even though they were not sounding like Alan Terrell and didn't have the production skills so we thought, okay, then maybe find a way to get those records out. And I thought the best way was doing by sub labels. And like, you know, made a small label more house orientated, label more electro orientated, a label for all the guys from the local scene, and a techno label. And they gave me a lot of freedom again to put out different stuff that was even more diverse. But I thought it made a little bit more understandable for the younger generations who were just listening to techno stuff. And they maybe didn't listen to Larry Heard. Maybe they didn't discover Larry Heard yet. But if you listen to techno music, or so let's say you buy the Clone Basement series because you like the straight on techno stuff, or the more, at some point you will discover Larry Heard, I'm sure. At some point. But it doesn't match on one label, at least not in the way we were doing it.
So how many of these sub-labels do you think you have by now? Do you even know?
I'd never counted. Probably like 15 or something like that. Yeah, and some only had like one or two, three records, and others are like up to 30 or something now. four now. I probably even the Clone Royal Oak series got like, I think 42 records now. Mm. Yeah.
It's actually really appropriate, perhaps, then, that as a DJ, you felt so pulled in so many directions that you didn't want to use different aliases for different kinds of sets. So instead of changing yourself as a DJ, you just mimicked your DJing interest back into the label, which is exactly how you started it, which is a DJ wanting to just play music that you liked and couldn't get your hands on.
Yeah, totally, yeah. But it's confusing for a lot of people, so that's probably... like I said, my booking agent said, well, you should just stick to this or just stick to that. And a lot of DJs have that, you know, once you get to a certain level, you get booked for main stages, they expect you to play a certain thing. And I always try to fight it and just, you know, play whatever I like to play.
Well, Clone has been fighting the good fight all this time. So, Serge, I want to thank you for your time today. Thank you for speaking to us.
Thanks.